So you're just saying about that first play, Sound of an Axe in the Forest.
Yeah.
You saw it. Yeah, no, well, I...
We like your review. I think I was in 6th or 7th grade, I'm not sure. But yeah, I remember the feeling of comfort, and I guess it was a sense of power, or what you might say empowerment now, you know. Mm-hmm. I felt comfortable up there. I wasn't nervous, you know. And I thought, wow, this is interesting that you do these things in public, you mm-hmm. know. And it's like, it's quite natural. And I thought, oh yeah, I can do this, mm-hmm. you know. There's an instinct, I guess.
Now, your parents, were they always thrilled about this career direction or not necessarily?
It sounds like you read something about it. Well, my mother died in 51. So I was almost 11. And my dad did not have a... Any idea what I was up to. He was a dear man. I adored him. He was my hero. You know, he was from northern Spain. He was a Gallego. He had this very thick Galician accent, and he was the only person in my childhood that called me by my name, Ramon.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone called me Ray or Raymond, and I hated it, you know. I loved my name.
Mm-hmm.
But he was the only one that used it. And I was born in a difficult situation, and they had to use forceps on me when I was born. And it crushed my left shoulder, and it left me with half the use of my left arm. So when I went to register for the draft at age 18, it caused me to be 4F.
Mm-hmm.
And it's basically what, I guess, kept me out of Vietnam, because mm-hmm. a lot of my friends went. I was exactly the age. Mm-hmm. You know, in fact, I had two brothers there.
Yeah.
But my father felt that I was a cripple, and that despite that I'd worked as a caddy, carrying mm-hmm, big bags, mm-hmm. you know, from early spring till late fall every summer, you know, at this country club over in Dayton, and since I was 9 until I was 18, but he thought that I could never make a living as a laborer. And that he was old world in that thinking, you know. So he thought that I really had to go to school in order to have a chance in life. And so every paycheck, and mind you, there was just he made so little money. He was mm-hmm. a factory worker, you know. And he put aside a few dollars every week for me to go to college. And I didn't know this until my senior year. And I told him that I wanted to go over to New York and start a career as an actor. And he said, "Oh no, that's outrageous. No, you're going to go to college." You know? And so. Kind of to appease him more than anything, I took the entrance examination through the University of Dayton, and I guess it's known what I did. It's infamous what I did. I blew it, and I got a 3 out of a possible 100%.
But deliberately, right?
Deliberately. And the dean of men called him in, and I remember he never went anywhere with us, but he was going to find out about this, you know. And he walked up there with me. The university was actually right across the street from the factory.
Wow.
And so we went up one night after work. And I knew I was in trouble, man, because he never, as I say, never went anywhere mm-hmm. except to mass and to work, you know. And Wednesday nights, he belonged to what we call the old men's club. I mean, it's kind of sad but sweet. He'd go down to this old men's club, these old retired people, and they were all widowers, and all the women were widows, and they would dance, you know. He'd pay to dance, mm-hmm. you know, in this club. It was so sweet. We always thought he'd get married again. He never brought anyone home.
Mm-hmm.
They wouldn't have lasted long anyway with all us clowns. But at any rate, that he was convinced that I was not, you know, higher education kind of material. And so, you know, I was able to leave. And so I left. And mind you, he blessed me. He didn't quite have a clear idea what I was doing. It was just so foreign to him, you know. But until I was committed, you know, and I was there for a long time before I ever came home again.
Well,
and he blessed me then when he realized I was committed.
I just want to interject because I know that I want to throw out a name, and if you can put this into some context, but Father Drapp.
Father Al Graff, yeah. Yes. He was my confessor, and I was in our parish, Holy Trinity Parish. He was the assistant pastor there when I was a teenager. And he started the teen club, and he was very active and brought this great youthful energy. This was his first assignment, you know, as after his ordination, and I adored him. And he took a personal interest in me because he knew the dream I had and the difficulty I had dealing with my father. So he really came between my father and I and talked to my father, said, "Hey, this kid's got something, you know, let it, you know." And so I had flunked out of high school that year, and I couldn't get a diploma. So he advised me. He said, "Look, go to summer school, get the diploma. Your dad will realize you're trying, you know." Mm-hmm. And take this entrance examination. So I sort of compromised. I went. I did get the diploma. Right. I went to summer school, right. But I threw the entrance examination. And so my dad was furious. But Father Al told him that, you know, there was more at stake here than he realized. And so he kind of eased the way. He loaned me the dough.
To go out.
Get started. Yeah, he did.
And how did the rising generation factor into this?
Really, because I'm familiar now because I just read this in the book. I'm going through the book.
What was that, and how did that come into play? Was because that
you've really done some research. The rising generation was a weekly talent show in Dayton, Ohio, and it was live Saturday afternoon, and it was an amateur show. All show business that there were musicians and dancers and singers and all and magicians, you know, and all these acts, and they would compete every week, and then after you'd watch the show, you'd write down on a postcard who you thought should win that week and send it in, and the one, of course, with the most votes would win. And I was watching the show; it'd been on for years, and finally, in the summer of my senior year. I was, and I thought, you know what, I could do a recitation, a soliloquy, a monologue, and compete. They'd never had that before. So I went out and I auditioned, and they said, "Yeah, we'd like you on." So I went on, and I did this poem by James Weldon Johnson. I know all this is fresh now because I'm just
looking at it in
the book. And he was an ordained minister, a black minister down south. And he would take the scriptures and try to make them come alive for his congregation during his sermons. And he took Genesis, you know, and wrote a version of Genesis that was so powerful and poetic and so down to earth. And I loved it, and I memorized it, and I did it on the air, and I won my week, you know, the week I was on, I won. And there was some... You know, he was talking about, I was trying to remember the other day because somebody asked me about it, and I said, "Oh, yes." And he's talking about God walking around and being lonely, and he decides to make things, you know. And he said he walked out onto the edge of the world, and he sat down, and you know, that's the kind of language he used. And he reached out and took the light that was left over between making the sun and the moon, he took in his hands, he rolled it around in the bowl, and he set it in the sky as the moon. And he said, "That's good." You know, that was, he made yeah, that all these kind of different thing, right? things. He sat down on the side of a river. And he still wasn't happy. He was still lonely. "I'm still lonely," he said. "I think I'll make me a man." Mm-hmm. A man. Whoa. Reached down and picked up the hunk of clay, and he formed it and worked on it. Then he breathed into it life, and there you have it. So I won. I was much better than I am.
No, what was there was a prize involved with that as well?
Yes. And when you won, you know, a weekly event, it's like these shows now, they have American Idol.
Right, so right.
You come back again.
Right.
So I came back for the finals, all the winners that had won that half season or whatever, and I did another recitation. Can't remember what that one was, but I won the whole thing.
Wow!
And the prize was a trip to New York for 4 or 5 days with an escort, and a CBS audition.
Now this was before or after you had gone out with father Drapp's encouragement? Was this, or was it the same trip? Was, what was the first time you went out? Was it with this Rising Generation? Mm-hmm. Wow. So you were out for a few days, and then you went back.
I think it was around, maybe it was September 1958. Mm-hmm. That summer I had won, and I took the prize, and I went on the journey. My brother Manuel and I flew out to New York, and they put us in a hotel, and and I went to this audition, and I did one of these recitations for the guy at CBS, the casting director, Robert Dale Martin was his name. And he was very encouraging, and he said the most important thing, and what I needed to hear. He said, you know, I think you're good. He said, and you have great potential. He said, but you can't do it in Dayton. He said, if you want to grow, you have to come to New York. And that was all I needed. I thought, wow, now I had some encouragement.
And so then it was
from
with
somebody in New York.
Right. You know. And it was then with Father Drapp's assistance that you actually made the move.
I went the following January.
Wow.
Yeah, in fact, the end of January 1959. Because when I arrived in New York, I remember it was the first or second day, the headlines were Buddy Holly was killed in an airplane crash.
Day of the Music died. Yeah. So you, at what point, not, I guess it was not long after you came out there, you sort of paid tribute to Robert Dale Martin, as well as someone else. So what was, how did that come together? What motivated that?
I had difficulty in New York with everybody and my name. And it was like, oh, geez, you know, people couldn't pronounce it, you know. They said, well, you don't look Spanish, you know, you look so Irish. I said, oh, geez. And I just got so tired of trying to pronounce it for people, spell it for people. Oh, you don't look like a Ramon. okay, fine. So I decided to create a makeup, you know. I thought, okay, I'll try to fit in. One of the big mistakes of my life. And I just started using the name Martin Sheen. I took the Martin from Robert Dale Martin, and I took the Sheen from Bishop Fulton J. Sheen, who was at that time the auxiliary bishop of New York. And he was also the first televangelist. Mm-hmm. And he was very popular, very powerful and bright, articulate man. He was a very handsome man, and he had a primetime television show every Tuesday night for a half hour. He'd give a lecture. Can you imagine giving a lecture at primetime in the 50s and being a star? And he was. And I'd watch him when I was a boy, but I didn't think of him as a clergy. You know, I didn't know what his philosophy or theology or what politics. I just thought of him as this dramatic actor. He had such a delivery. He was so powerful. He had these magnetic eyes. A very handsome man. And I thought, that's, I want to be like him. And so I took his name, Sheen, and I put him together, and it sounded right. And I just thought, I'll give this a try. So the next audition I went out for, they said, yeah, what's your name? I said, Martin Sheen, you know. And then along the way, it takes a while to get used to a new name, you know. So along the way, people would call me by excuse me, Martin. I wouldn't have a clue. Somebody would say, I think he's asking about the who? What's that?
Right.
Well, he said, Martin, I've been calling you.
Right.
I said, oh, that's right, I'm Martin. You know? But I never took it seriously, and I never intended for it to stick. And I'll tell you what happened. I never changed my name officially. It's still officially Ramon Estevez. It's on my driver's license, my passport, marriage license. We're married under that name. Mm-hmm. All the children are born and baptized under that name. And I never will change it. I never wanted to. But what I did was I started making money under the name Sheen. And now I would get a check with my name on it. And they'd say, we have to take out, you know, Social Security.
Right. I'd
say, we need your Social Security card.
Right.
Well, my card had a different
name. Right, right, right.
So I wrote the Social Security Department and told them my dilemma. I said, my real name is Ramon. Here is my number.
Right.
And
be
and
careful, we'll have to block that out. We'll cut that out. I don't think you want that out there.
Yeah. Area code 497.
Right.
and so they gave me a new card. They sent me a new card with the name Martin Sheen, the same number. So wow. I have two cars. I
wow.
still have them.
Wow.
You know, so I can work under either name.
Right.
In fact, if this gig doesn't work,
right.
I'll go back to the old name.
Right, right,
when I
right.
become a congressman. Wait,
yeah, right. So, and just as a quick follow-up, how was it resolved that certain of your kids decided to stay with it and certain of them, I mean, I know that it sounds like all of your kids, in a lot of ways, like you, in the way that your father was your hero. I've heard each of them say that you were a hero to them. But the decision about do you keep, like, you know, Charlie decided to go with Sheen, Emilio did not. What was that? Were those decisions that you were a party to, or
no? In fact, the only one I tried to influence was Emilio, because Charlie got out of hand. I mean, we looked around and Charlie was gone.
Right.
You know, he left here like 16, 17.
Oh, really?
He was gone. It was like. He, you know, Charlie, you know, he was a terrific baseball player. He was playing on the team over here at Santa Monica High, and he was failing in his studies, and he did something. You know, the teachers called me and said, you've got to talk to this lad of yours. He's not going to graduate, and as a result, he cannot play in the championship, you know, series. They were on their way to the championship. Mm-hmm. He was one of their best pitchers. And so I went and talked to the big mistake. I went down and said, well, you know, he's got a great heart and he's got a great, you know, slider or fastball, whatever it was, right. And you really ought to continue. And no, they said, it has to cost him something. He's going to misbehave. He has to get his studies right. And so I went back to Charlie and I told him, I said, look, you know, you've got to get squared away with this thing. They're not going to let you play. He said, to hell with it. He decided to become an actor. And he went out on his first audition and he got the job.
So
he was gone, you know what I mean? And it was like, and it's true, it's not a joke, it's true. And the movie was called, Heidi. Movie. Next thing we knew, he was in Switzerland, somewhere, filming this big movie, Heidi.
Is that the one that interrupted the football game? Remember there was a famous, I believe that was Heidi, where it comes on in the middle of a, we interrupt our game, the playoff game that's about to in overtime, and it's the Heidi game.
It sounds like something Charlie right. would do.
So, and then Emilio, though, stuck with Estevez. So, and most of your kids are still...
Yeah, I asked Emilio to really seriously consider it, because I didn't want him to make the same mistake I did, you know. My father came to see me, and the only time he ever saw me on stage was in The Subject Was Roses, which was this tremendous hit on Broadway, Frank D. Gilroy's... play that won the Pulitzer Prize that year, won everything really, and he retired from the NCR. He was on his way to Spain. He stopped in New York, and he stayed with us, and he came to see the play, and he was just so. He didn't say as much, but looking at the marquee, you know, who's this guy? You know, it just didn't gel,
right.
And I felt his pain, and I was disappointed in myself. Even before he saw it, I mean, I thought, I don't know why, you know. It's odd. In some ways, I was freed by being this new guy, kind of. But in some ways, I still carried the real guy inside, you know. And so I wanted my children to have kind of, you know, not be forced into making a decision like I did. And I assured Emilio when he was thinking of changing. He talks about it in the book, too. And he said that he tried it out, you know, and just typing it up.
Right.
He said, Emilio Sheen. That sounded so stupid. He said,
the EE sounds cool, yeah.
So he decided to keep it. So I felt very relieved. Ramon, no problem. Renee, no problem. Both of them were actors, too. You know?
The last thing before you sort of breaking through in The Subject with Roses, the last question before that is to do with the Living Theater, which I don't know that many people necessarily fully know about, and particularly. Julian Beck, and just I know he had a profound impact on you, so
he did,
maybe you can just again explain.
Yeah, Julian Beck was my first mentor in New York. Yeah, he was the co-founder of the Living Theater with his wife Judith Molina, and I came to the theater. I was in a little group called the Actors Co-op. A bunch of us literally just pulled our resources and rented a loft, and we'd put on little plays and scenes and invite agents and producers. And try and get work, you know. And one of the lads in that group, John Wynn Evans, was working as a curtain puller at the Living Theater, and he was leaving that job to go on Broadway with a role, and he asked me, would you like to take over my old job? I said, I'd be delighted. So I went down to the Living Theater, and I met Julian Beck and Judith Molina, And they hired me at $5 a week. I was worth every penny. And they, you know, they were embarrassed. They, you know, we just don't have any money. We're a slow, you know, we're a small, low-budget theater off Broadway. But we have a friend downtown who has a, you know, a free food. What do you call it? A soup kitchen. Mm-hmm. And they don't charge anything, and they won't preach to you or, you know, try and save your soul. They just, if you're hungry, they will feed you, and that's all that they do. And I said, well, great. And so I went down there, and the place was the Catholic Worker, and their friend, of course, was Dorothy Day, who's been elevated to, you know, she's on her way to becoming a saint in the Catholic Church. It's an amazing woman. And that was my, that was really the start of my my real consciousness about activism, social justice, nonviolent protest, because that's, they did a lot of that.
And just for the record, I know you are not necessarily proud about this, or you don't show off about it, but I know you've been, how many times have you been arrested for peaceful protesting?
Not enough. We're still at war.
Right.
As of count, I used to keep a count because of my age, and so, but I haven't been arrested for a while. I was 67.
Wow!
I should go backwards. Right. 67. Right. You know, I'm 71. I haven't been arrested.
Right, you gotta go out there. You got four more to catch up on. But
I couldn't get arrested for. Well, I chose not to during the Gulf War because I was doing the West Wing, and I went to a demonstration at. The Air Force Base up north here, Vandenberg.
Yeah,
and we were protesting the missile launches there, nuclearism, and I hadn't anticipated getting arrested, and I got arrested, and since 9/11, they took this
more seriously. Yeah,
you know.
Yeah,
you know, trespass on federal property. Mm-hmm. You know. You know. And so I was facing 6 months, and I knew that if I went to trial and I lost, they'd take you away straight away. You know, it might give you a week to, you know, get ready. But yeah, you've got to be. And that would spoil my time with the West Wing. And I already had a contract with them. And I thought, so my lawyer just advised me to make a deal, you know, plead guilty and take it, whatever they give you. Because they won't put you in prison. And I said, okay. So, but they did give me 3 years probation. And then, just as I started serving the 3 years probation, the war in Iraq broke out. And I was stuck like...
What do you do? Yeah.
You know, I went to demonstrations, but I wouldn't cross the line because I knew that, you know, they'd take you right from
there.
They'd look at you, hey, this guy's on probation, take him away, you know. And that way, again, would be the end of mine. And it would... I felt it would seriously harm the West Wing. And I had a commitment to that. And they'd have sued me anyway.
Yeah. So to jump backwards, though, you had that time, between the Living Theater and film sort of clicking for you, you did a lot of TV, you did a lot of theater, right?
Well, the Living Theater was a real important element in my life because I came there in December 1959. And they were doing The Connection, which was a huge hit off-Broadway about drug addiction, and it was a mixture of jazz. And they were doing, in repertory, they were doing a Pirandello play, and they were getting ready to do a Brecht play, and they had Monday night programs when they were dark. They'd do readings, and they'd pass the hat, you know, and there was all this activity in this place, and it was on fire. It was wonderful, you know. And I'd never been around such people. And Julian was like this brilliant man. He was a director and an actor and a writer and a producer and an actor. And he was the husband of the lady, the leading lady. And the two of them ran this place, and it was amazing. And Merce Cunningham had a studio on the top. And John Cage had a studio up there. And the Women's Strike for Peace was kind of started in that building. And Bam the Bomb was meeting there all the time. And it was all this activity. And they were pacifists, and they were nonviolent, you know, vegetarians. I never heard of such people, you know. And they just had a profound effect on me. And in, And they received while I was there. The original cast of The Connection went to make the movie and then go to London to do a production of The Connection there. And it left open all the parts. And I auditioned and I got one of the major parts. And it was the first time I got paid for acting, you know. And I played. And while I was playing, they got an invitation to represent the United States in the Théâtre des Nations, the Theater of Nations Festival in Paris in 1961. It was a huge coup, like, you know, it came from the State Department to these radicals, you know. And they accepted it, and they decided to make a big European tour. And Jan and I went, and it was just amazing. We played in Italy, in Rome, and in Torino, and Milan, and we went to Paris, where the festival, and they won the Grand Prix in Paris. And we went to Germany. We played in Berlin weeks before the wall went up. Between East and West Berlin, we were there, and we got invited to the Life magazine photographer in Berlin invited us to his house for a supper one day while we were there, and there was all this talk of walls going to go up. I said, "This is ridiculous. Who would permit? Khrushchev would never permit. It's outrageous. Why would they put a wall up and divide it?" By the time we got home, it was up, you know, and we were in Paris when it came down. Isn't that interesting?
That's years funny. Later. Wow.
But Julian Beck and Judith May had this profound impact. They just opened my mind and my heart and my imagination to all the possibilities of what it was to be alive, what it was to be an artist.
So if they did that in a way for the theater, I don't know that this was necessarily your first role, but it was the first big one. The person who would have done that would have been Malick, right? In a way, when you found out that I've read... just even how you, maybe you can talk about how you first even crossed paths leading up to finding out that you were a part of Badlands. What was the process? Because it was not, he was not necessarily a known entity before that, was
he? No, on the contrary. Yep. I mean, he was basically an AFI former graduate, you know. Before that, he'd been a Rhodes Scholar and a teacher at MIT. He was a photographer and a professional journalist, you know. Brilliant, brilliant man. And I.
How did you guys first hear about each other?
Well, you know, I had, you know, I'd done a couple of films while I was still in New York, but then, and one of, in 1969, we went down to Mexico to do a part in a film, and it had to be completed here when we finished the location. It was Catch 22. Mm-hmm. And so we came up out of Mexico and came to Los Angeles. And I had only intended to stay here while I finished Catch 22. So I had a few scenes here in town, and then I had a few in Italy. Mm-hmm. And so we just rented a house, and we figured we're going back to New York, you know, when we finished this film. And then I started to get work here after I finished Catch 22. And I went back to do a play, but the family stayed, and I played it in last, and I came back. And we just decided that... there was more work opportunity here, and so we gave the apartment up in New York and stayed, you know.
And in this case, I guess you were, was it an audition for Badlands?
What happened, it's interesting because I was doing a lot of television, and occasionally I would do a film, although, gosh, it was hard to get a movie. There were so few movies done, actually, you know. There were more... what they called movies of the week on television. And there was a lot of episodic television and a lot of series, you know, and there were just the three networks at that time, ABC, NBC, CBS, and PBS. You know, they did plays and stuff and specials. And that was about it. And then you do commercials. I did voiceovers, you know. Mm-hmm. To supplement income. That was a major part of my income, doing voiceovers. But, and so one day, my agent asked me, you know, they're looking for somebody, there's a haberdashery that's doing a commercial, and they're looking for somebody to model a pair of pants on television. You know, would you be interested in make a few bucks? And I said, yeah, okay. So I went over to this hotel in Hollywood, near Franklin Avenue, I remember. It was kind of a little kind of a what you'd call a boutique motel hotel now, and it was only two story, and I found my way to the people there who were doing the audition, and I put the pants on and I did some, you know, this and that, you know, like I thought I was a model, and I left, you know, I didn't get the job, but and as I was leaving, and I was coming out the door, walking on the sidewalk, and there was a big bay window on the first floor room, whatever, when the lady is banging on the window, telling me to come in. I said, hey, okay. So I went in. She said, hey, I know you. You're a wonderful actor, and I want you to audition. I want you to do a screen test for this film. The director's out of town, and I told him about you. Her name was Diane Dürfner. Mm-hmm. I adored her. I adored Diane Durfee. That's almost poetic, isn't it? But I did. She was a lovely lady.
Right.
She, and so, did I say she was the casting director?
Yeah.
Okay. So, she said, look, if I just, I don't want to hold you up, she said, but this film is really very special, and this director is wonderful. It's his first time out, and I've talked to him about you, and he doesn't think you're right, and so forth. And so, but I'd just like to film you, the little tape on you, like you're doing right now.
Right.
And show it to him. Surprise, look who came by, you know, and see what he said. I said, okay. And so she gave me a couple of what we call sides, a couple of scenes. Could you go study these straight away and come back? I said, I will. And I went out on the street, and I remember sitting on the sidewalk down near Hollywood Boulevard and studying this thing. And it began to ring a bell, and I came back and she said, are you ready? And it was just like this. She had a little camera set up and you couldn't move this way or that because, you know, it wasn't lit, right, you'd be out of frame, right? And so you had to enact the whole thing, you know, kind of like here. And I said, this character, this guy, Kip, he sounds familiar. Would this be any relation to that horrible crime over in Nebraska back in the late 50s, Charlie Starkweather? They said, yep, that's him, all right. And I said, yeah, I remember this guy, okay. So I did this audition. She off camera read the little girl's lines, and I read, and I did the Charlie stuff on camera, you know. And I thought, well, this is interesting. And I left, and I forgot all about it, you know. And a few weeks later, I get a call from this guy, Terrence Malick. Oh, well, he said, you know, I saw your tape, and gosh, I'd sure like to meet you. I didn't think you were right for it. I'd like to meet you. Would you come? And I will, I said. He was just fascinating, you know. And even on the phone, you could tell that he was very shy. And I met him. I went over to his house. He was renting a house from his friend George Siegel, who moved from a location somewhere in the Hollywood Hills. I couldn't tell you where it was now. And I remember I was terrified because they had a dog. I'm not joking. Named Obibbling. He was in the movie. He's the dog that the father shot. And I'm terrified of this dog. He was one of those huge, what do you call them, Great Danes or something. And he was very friendly, but I've always been terrified of him. Strange dog. And so he had to assure me the dog was not going to kill me if I came into the house. And I did. And of course it was Terry. And he was just so wonderful and disarming and sensitive and funny and self-effacing. I just liked hanging out with him. I didn't care if I got the part or not. I said, this is a very interesting guy. And I thought he was just one. And we talked about anything but movies. We still don't talk about anything. You know, that's the last thing we talk about is film or movies or acting. We had a mutual love of James Dean. And it turned out that was part of the character that I didn't know about.
I was just
going to
say, yeah.
I didn't know that at the time, you know. And so he said, you know, I thought you were wrong, but I saw the little video that Diane did, and I'd like you to consider, you know, would you mind coming and reading with me? And the little girl, we have this young girl that's going to play Holly. I will, I said. And I don't know, a week or so later, I came back, and there's this little, beautiful little redhead, friendly Texan, you know, Sissy Spacek, and together we got to be friends. She played guitar and she twirled the, you know, she was a drum major, you know, she knew how to do that. And we would we would sit there and do the scenes, you know, of Kitten and Holly, just like this, you know, you're out of frame, Martin, you're out of frame, Sissy, get a little closer. So we're like this, you know, trying to act like this, you know. And it got to be great fun. And I love going over there. I don't know. I couldn't even tell you how many times I've gone over. Maybe a half a dozen times over a period of 3 or 4 months. I don't even remember. Mm-hmm. And I didn't realize it, but he was seeing other people as mm-hmm. well, which is fine. Mm-hmm. And I learned later some of them were very well-known actors mm-hmm. and wonderful actors besides. But I didn't care. I just loved hanging around him. You know, he was such a sweet, dear man. And his wife, Jill, was wonderful. And she was, they were both like Southerners, you know, and she had this wonderful, I could just listen to her talk endlessly. She was this beautiful woman from Tennessee, I think she was, and just.
Were you, and speaking of voices though, didn't he give you some kind of a direction about your voice for the character? Was it like his own voice or something? Like, so you, that wasn't, it didn't sound like you normally sound when you were playing.
Oh, no, well, it was kind of a attitude. Kit had a kind of an image of himself. It wasn't real. Mm-hmm. And so he tried to, Terry, I mean, it was in the text, you know, but Kit kind of spoke a different language, and he lived in a totally different place. He was a legend in his own mind, you know, and people would come to realize it eventually, you know. And they will remember that they spoke to him, you know, and remember what he looked like and what he wore and what all he said to them and how he said it. And they will enact it, you know, in future generations, kind of, you know. So this lunatic Kit had this image. And so it was kind of an elevated, kind of whacked out reality for him, you know, that he had an opinion about things that was important. That it be recorded, you know, and that his feelings were, you know, they could be of some importance as well, although, you know, it's more important for everyone else's feelings to be considered, you know, but I would do the considering, you know.
Right.
He told me, I remember he told me about the gun. He said, you know, this guy, the gun is like a magic wand, you know, somebody gets in the way or somebody gets, they're gone. You know, it's like, poof, you're gone. Right. He didn't kill anyone.
He just made them go.
Was
it clear? I mean, it sounds to me from what I, when you knew it was a special part early on. So when you found out that you had gotten it?
It kind of, you know, like a lot of things, it kind of, something you want so badly, lives in a different place in you. You don't realize how much you want it. You can never articulate how much you want, how much it would mean to you to have it, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's like, I guess, like winning the lottery. You're thinking, oh, geez, you're already spending the dough, you know? But you never really think you're going to win it.
Right.
It's just a fantasy, you know? And so that's what I kind of had about it. And as I say, I knew other guys were being considered. And I never read the script. He never given me the script. I know I've gotten little signs and information as I went along, you know. And then one night I was over in Paramount. I was doing an episode of Mannix, which was a series, because I was doing a lot of television at the time. I was doing Mannix, and I called Janet, but we didn't have cell phones at the time, so I'd call home. You know, from the studio phone or a cell phone or a pay phone. Say, I'm on my way. Can I pick up anything? Or you need anything? How's it going? Blah, blah, blah. Okay. She said, oh, by the way, Terry called and he'd like you to stop by on your way home this night. And Paramount wasn't that far, you know. I said, okay. So I said, it's another one of those wonderful evenings I'm going to spend with this wonderful group over there with Abimelech and Terry and Jill and Sissy. Mm-hmm. So I went over, and he was kind of in a hurry. He came to the door and said, Martin, he said, I just want to give you the script. I want you to read it now. I'll talk to you later. I said, okay, fine. He said, I'm sorry. I've got, you know, a lot of stuff I got to do. He was very near, you know, starting production, because I think it was already spring, you know. And so this is the first time I'd seen the script.
Right.
And I went home that night and I read it. Finally realized what all the excitement was about. I mean, I've never read anything like this before, you know? Where did this guy come from? He's so disarming. That, you know, what kind of a genius conceives of this and kind of keeps it all hidden, you know? He's that good, you know? And I thought, it was the first time in my life that I realized I had an opportunity to play an important mm-hmm. part, you know, in a film. I knew this guy was a genius. And then a few days later, he called me and said he'd like me to do it. And could we talk to your agent? And I said, oh, Terry, you know, I've never done this before, I said, but that's the best script I've ever read. And now it's the best part I've ever been offered. I said, but I can't do it. Oh, why not? I said, well, I'm too old. Terry, I'm going to be 32 this summer. This is in 1972. Mm-hmm. And I said, I'm too old. The character you've written is 19. He's very much 19. He said, oh, I know that. He said, but you know, I've been thinking if you would do it, I'd make the character a bit older. Would you consider it? I said, of course. I said, I'll do. He said, okay, well, I'll talk to you in a few days. And I said, okay. And we were not in this house yet. We were in a house over on the other side of the highway, mm-hmm. about a half a mile from here. And I had to leave very early in the morning to get to the Paramount. I was still working, I was doing that show. And I remember driving along Pacific Coast Highway and the sun was just coming up. And I was listening to Dylan. There was a recording I was playing, Desolation Row. I don't know what album it was from. Is that song, you know? Desolation Row. Whatever that wonderful sight, wonderful imagery in that song. And it hit me that I was going to do this part in that movie with this guy. And I began to weep with joy and exultation. I can't explain. I've never had a moment like that in my life. And I had to pull off the side of the road by the ocean. And just there was nobody around. The sun's coming up and Dylan is playing and I'm weeping because I got the part of my life and I knew it.
So you guys, you knew from the beginning that movie, did you have the sense that it was going to become this classic? I mean, today it's on every list of the greatest movies of all time. It's and you saw that coming.
I have to confess.
Yeah, no, that's fine. Yeah.
Declare. Yeah, yeah, I saw it coming. Yep. And a lot of the crew didn't. I remember some of the crew.
Well, there weren't many to begin with, right?
There's a tiny little bit. Right. Like, the hell's this guy thinking he's doing? You know, those regular guys, you right. know, do all the movies and such.
Because he'd shoot forever, right?
The kind of thing is this. Right. You see him doing this and that. You know, they didn't get it. I said, a clue who this guy is.
Was the thing they didn't get that he's going on for the shooting? You guys would shoot forever, right?
Or that the leading characters were so disarming, right. You know, they weren't declarative. They were like these mythical characters, you know, and they were a reflection of the country we all knew and loved. You know, it was about, and particularly Kit's character was about an image. It wasn't the reality, you know. He had this image of himself, you know. And he, you know, he was like a real reflection of the enormous insanity that lived at the surface of everything real.
Right.
You know?
So the second of the iconic roles, the ones that will be remembered 100 years after all of us are gone, 1,000 years, you know, when people look back at movies, the second one is obviously Willard. And I have to just say, I did not know until I was doing some homework for this that they were originally looking at Harvey Keitel, is that right?
He was shooting it. Yeah, he was shooting
so
it.
So what happened that led to you coming here on this private, not necessarily with him, but like, how did you'd met Coppola before.
Yeah, I met him over in New York, back in the 60s, I met him for a film. His first movie, Robert Duvall, The Rain People.
Yeah.
I met him about that, and he was very interested in me doing it. And I was, you know, I was interested in doing it with him, and but he couldn't wait for me, and I was doing another movie, another show or play or something. I don't know, but I liked him, and I liked his persona. You know, I thought, geez, this guy's
really another interesting
yeah,
character.
Yeah, I thought he was a really interesting guy, and he was from New York. You know, it was a whole different tone to him. You know, very confident. He was not like Terry at all. I mean, he was like, you know, he was very colorful and very even and direct and very confident, you know, very outspoken and confident and very sweet. I remember him being extremely sensitive to all the actors. He loved actors.
Well, and I read that he loved you in, we were talking earlier about The Execution of Private Slavik. He's apparently loved you in that.
He saw that. I had just seen that in one of
his interviews. And that also, I had no idea that you had auditioned for Michael Corleone.
I did, yeah. Yeah, I did a screen test.
Wow.
I've never seen it.
You never seen it. And
I don't want you to see it either. No, you. I forbid it.
So, and you yourself apparently felt that he was right to go with Pacino, right?
Oh, he's the only guy.
Yeah.
I came up with Al.
Oh, you suggested?
Oh, God, yes.
Oh, wow.
Well, I didn't.
Because you knew each other from the Living Theater?
Yeah, exactly. Right. Yeah, Al was in the Living Theater.
Right. So, anyway, now you finally.
Janet was the first one to say Al would be a major star. Because a little Al, really?
Right. The ethnic guy.
She saw him work, you know. Right. He did a scene from a play called Hello Out There. Mm-hmm. You know, we saw it in a classroom or somewhere. So, oh, my God. Little Al. You know, because he was so non-actor. He was very New York.
Right.
And he was very funny and sweet.
Right.
And, you know, and we thought, God, no. He was just so nice, you know, and funny to have around.
Well, that worked out for all.
Boom, you saw him on stage, and suddenly, you know, the world changed, you know.
So you did finally end up working with Coppola here on this one, and you come out thinking it's 16 weeks, right? You're going out to the middle of nowhere for 16 weeks. And how does that become a year and 3 months? What I mean, I know documentaries have been made about this, so it's a big question.
Wonderful documentary.
But if you had to synopsize, forget what did you land there, and what did you come upon?
Well, first of all, I had talked to Fred Roos about that film a long time, months and months and months before, and I had committed to a film in Italy. And I was signed and committed to going. And I had to start working on a film in Switzerland and Rome. I was going to be Ava Gardner's leading man.
Wow. Nice.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, not bad.
And, I really liked that. I adored her, Ava Gardner. So I signed on for this film called The Cassandra Crossing. It had one of the great casts of all time, including Ava Gardner and Sophia Loren and Burt Lancaster and Richard Harris and Lee Strasberg and O.J. Simpson. His first movie is true. And a mess of people.
Right.
And it may have been one of the worst movies ever made, but it was great doing it, and it was the greatest bunch of people. I adored them. It was a wonderful experience, and we all went over to Rome, and you know, the kids didn't have a clue who any of these people were, and they'd come on the set to visit, and Ava became like an aunt to my son Ramon. They remained friends the rest of her life. Did you know that?
I did not.
Yeah, they were friends. Yeah, she was like an aunt to him.
So
he didn't have a clue who she was. Just this lady
just
who loved to
the
talk
pretty
to
lady, right?
Yeah, and play games on the set. And they all remember O.J. very well. He was still playing football at the time. He was very sweet. I beat him up in the movie, you know. He didn't mess with me.
Right.
What a joke. He was like a
he's a big guy. But there was a concern at some point that was going to prevent you from doing Apocalypse, or that the next one.
I never had an offer for Apocalypse before.
Okay.
They're just checking. They always check your availability. They cost. I'm committed. You know.
Right.
Okay.
Can't do it.
Enough said.
Right.
I never read the script. I didn't know anything about Apocalypse. So I went off to Rome. We were there for a couple of months, and one night the phone rang at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. Oh, who's calling at this hour? Mm-hmm. Why don't I go to the phone? And then in those days, you couldn't just call direct all. There was a call from the USA. Are you so-and-so? I am. Yeah, I'll put you through. Right. And here's Fred Roos on the other side of the line. Right. Martin. Yeah, I said, yeah, Fred. How you doing? Well, how's it going over there? I said, I'm doing great. Where are you calling from? He said, well, I'm in Manila, and I'm just wondering, how long are you going to be on that film? In Rome. I said, you know what? I got a couple more weeks. He said, oh, okay. Well, I'm just checking. I said, well, nice to talk to you, Fred. All the best. And we hung up. And I'll never forget this. I swear to God, as long as I live. I came back to the bed, and Janet said, who was that? I said, that was Fred Roos. Well, what did he want? I said, they want me to come to the Philippines to do Apocalypse Now. He said that, she said. I said, no. She said, well, how do you know? I said, I just do.
Yeah.
And I went to sleep and forgot all about it. And a few weeks later, he called again. He said, how much time do you have left? I said, well, in fact, I've got a few days off. This is Holy Week, you know. Easter is coming up that Sunday. He said, could you come to Los Angeles during the Easter break and meet with Francis? He's back in the States now. He'd like to meet with you if you have time. And I said, yeah, I'm off Thursday, Friday, Saturday. I have to be back in Rome on Easter Sunday to start working on Easter Monday. Could you come over? He said, I will, I said. Okay. He said, we'll meet you at LAX. And Francis would like to talk to you. We'll meet you in the... we had it all arranged that I would take a flight, a Italia. I think it was nonstop direct in those days, from Rome to Los Angeles. And I would meet Francis in the lounge of the Philippine Airlines, and we'd have time to discuss all of this, because he was on his way back to Manila. And meanwhile, I had learned that they had taken a hiatus and that Harvey was released and that they were looking for someone to replace Harvey in the lead role.
And you had seen the script and everything at that point or not?
No, I hadn't seen anything. Yeah. I didn't know. I knew it was about Vietnam, right. But I didn't have a clue.
The Hearts of Darkness aspect of it? No.
Mm-hmm. And so, I made plans to go over, and meanwhile, Janet said, well, look, you know, as long as you're going to go over now, you can take all the children's winter clothing, because it's now springtime, and, you know, we had all this ski stuff, you know, all this puffed up stuff that we'd taken over so the kids could have winter stuff in Europe, and now it was useless, and could I take all that home and save us the trouble of packing all that stuff up when we came home after the filming? I said, yeah, great. So she packed up 3 or 4 huge bags with all the children's winter clothing in it. And I landed at LAX and got the bags, and I'm going through customs. And the customs officer said, oh, what do we have here? Are you opening a haberdashery? What are you doing with all? I said, oh, my. I said, you know what? These are all my children's clothing, and I'm just bringing them home. They said, oh, where are the children? I said, well, they're still in Rome. Oh, so what are you planning to do with all of this stuff, sir? And I said, I'm just going to take it home to my... They took me and said, they went through every bag, every piece of... They thought that I was trying to bring garments in for sale. It was outrageous. And I was there for like 2 hours trying to talk to them and swearing that these were my children's clothes and I had to sign documents and oh, Jesus. And by the time I got out of there, Fred Roos was pulling his hair out. Francis was waiting up in the lounge, and he had to leave any minute. So Fred Roos said, leave the bags here. Right. You know, when I finally got through. What gap? So come. And we ran over now to the Philippine Airlines lounge, and upstairs, and there's Francis. And, wow, he said, I thought you'd never show up. I thought you missed the plane. What's going on? I tried to explain. He said, never mind. He said, look, we've got a problem, and I'm just thinking that you would be, if you're interested, we might, you know, have you come and film with us in the Philippines when we get back to work. Would you think about that? I will, I said. He said, well, Fred will get you a script, and maybe we'll talk. I said, all right, fine. Off he went. Maybe we had 10 or 15 minutes tops. And he was gone. And I said, oh, my God. I went back down with Fred, and we got all the children's clothes. He drove me out here. We were in this house at the time, sure. And he gave me the script, and if I'm not mistaken, all this happened on Good Friday, 1976. And the next day was Saturday, and I read the script here, and I thought, oh, my God, another one, you know. One of those chances, one of those opportunities, one of those extraordinary things could happen here. So I read the script, and Fred Roos came to pick me up, and I had to get on a plane Sunday afternoon to go back to Rome. And he took me to the airport, and I took the script with me, and he says, well, we'll be talking. I still didn't have the part. And I'll never forget, I rode back, and what was great about it, I had first class, you know, because they paid for it. I was always cashing in the tickets to bring the gang, you know. Right. So here I am sitting up and with the overprivileged. And Martin, Marty,
that's
Balsam.
Right. Yeah.
Marty Balsam was sitting there. He was on his way to Rome to do a film. And we'd worked together on Catch-22. Hey, Martin, how you doing? Hey, Marty, how you doing? I'm doing great. What are you doing? I'm going to Rome to finish. And we had a great time. What is that all about? What's the script? I'm looking at the. I said, well, I don't know. There's a chance I might be doing this show in a short time. I said, well, all the best. And I got back to Rome, and we got back together, Jan and I. And I think it was the next day, Fred Roos called again and said, how soon can you get to Manila? I said, I'm finished. I think in about 3 or 4 days I can be there by then. He said, well, we're going to talk to your agents. Can we make a deal? I said, of course. And that was it, you know. And I went, a few days later, I went to Manila, and Janet went to L.A. And a few weeks later, she joined me, and we started.
So just briefly, though, when you land there and you see everybody who's already been operating, what was the environment? They were literally in the middle of a jungle doing...
They were up in a place called Balar in northern Luzon, and that's where they filmed the whole attack on the village.
Yeah.
And they had filmed all of that already. And they were now filming the stuff on the beach where we would land in the chopper. And
the napalm.
Napalm was coming, yeah. All of that was shot up there.
So... You've talked openly, and I wouldn't bring it up if it had never been discussed before, but you've said that you were going through a period of your life where you had been drinking a lot, and that opening scene of the film, when you shot that, that's how that came to be.
That was my 36th birthday. Yeah, I've been drinking all day that day,
So what transpired there?
Well, it was pretty embarrassing, obviously, you know. I couldn't sober up. And we were filming all day, and we got to the scene of how shall I say it, the scene we all remember.
Yeah.
And France and I had been talking all along about the character, because he had to start from scratch again, you know, with this guy, and we were trying to kind of form an idea about him. And mind you, that scene was shot in August. That would be August 3rd, 19. My birthday, obviously, is 76, and so, but we'd been shooting since June, I think. So, and then the big storm came, and we got knocked out. So we came back. I learned how to swim meantime, and took instructions on small arms fire and all that, all the weapons that a soldier would, because I was never in the army. I didn't know anything about these weapons and how to be a soldier. And they sent me a former Vietnam veteran who'd been badly wounded in Vietnam, Joe Lowry, who became dear friends. He trained me right here in his yard. This is before the pool was put in. It was a big. He walked in here first time, and he looked at it. He said, this looks like the place I got ambushed. And it was a rice paddy with trees on both sides. Right. And we became very close friends, and he trained me for the picture. And I went back, and then we started filming again. And
that's
when that sequence was shot. And it was not a real hotel. It was a... it was like a courthouse, and these were just upstairs. room, so they made it look like it, yeah.
Just misjudged the distance between the...
I did, yeah, because Joe had been trying to teach me some karate moves, you know, and he said, nothing's quicker than your own reflection. So if you practice in front of a mirror, you can see where it's coming, you know. He was teaching me all these macho moves, mm-hmm. kicking and bump, boom, you know, and mm-hmm. banging and bopping and boom. And I was doing all this stuff, and right. I was so drunk, I couldn't even stand up. And I got close to that mirror and whacked it. I thought, oh, Jesus, I hit the mirror. Oh, Christ, I'm bleeding. Oh, Jesus, what have I done? And I couldn't stop weeping, and I just went through a mess and of emotional upheaval, and Francis was off camera. Oh, Martin, I'm going to stop this now. Can you hear me? Listen, we don't have to go. I said, no, please let it go. I thought in my heart, I'm you know, I've wrestled this wretched demon before, you know, and I'm going to do it now on film. The hell with it. I'm going to have it out, you know, and I did, you know.
So when we see the scene, there's like a quick jump cut. Is that when you were debating whether or not to continue? Because we see you look at the blood, and it comes back, and you're white. You flip on the bed.
Yeah, I can't remember. It was hard for me. I never saw that scene.
Never. Still.
Not until the film opened, because it was not in the original version.
Yeah.
When the film opened in Cannes. In the summer of 79, you know, I heard that it wasn't in there, that he decided it was too distracting, and you know, it was just too hard to watch. And then when the American version opened, I heard it was put back in. But I didn't see the premiere. I didn't see the film until it had opened. I was in Hawaii. I was doing something else, and I came back. And it had opened and everything, and they'd done all the publicity. And they asked me, he said, now that you're back, because I was doing another movie, would you go and do some publicity? I said, I would. And so I went over to New York, and it was playing at the Ziegfeld. And a friend of mine wanted to see it. He'd been in the Army, and I had never been in the Army. He said, I've heard about it. And I said, okay. So I went with him to the Ziegfeld, and I saw it for the first time. And I was just stunned. I could not stop weeping when I saw it. I was weeping with relief and with joy and with some great sadness. When the scene started with that attack on the village, whenever I've seen it since, I just break into tears. Like, it's just so vulnerable, you know.
The last thing to do with that is just that, as has been famously reported, I mean, we had all kinds of off-scene drama like we were talking about, but for you, I think the worst point had to be when you had your heart attack at such a young age.
Yeah, well, that was way off camera.
Well, right. So I mean, when something started to happen, could you even fathom? I mean, not many 36-year-olds have heart attacks or come back 6 weeks after doing
that. True. Yeah.
So what was that?
Well, that was was quite a shock. Well, it was during the final phase of the film, because when I started, I think it was June of 76, or maybe it was May, I don't know, maybe earlier. It was around, you know, it was just after Easter when I started. And then we had the storm a few weeks later that broke everything, it just destroyed everything. And we had to be, you know, we had to be evacuated and came home. And that hiatus lasted 4 or 5 weeks, and then we went back and I did all the stuff in the, mm-hmm. in the hotel and the stuff where they gave me the job, you know, with J. Brees Spradley, who's passed away, incidentally. I just learned. Yeah, did you know that?
Yeah,
he passed away not too long ago. Yeah, so those scenes were shot. And can I tell a little story about that?
Yeah, whatever.
This young actor came over to shoot that sequence, Harrison Ford, and he was an unknown young actor, very handsome young fellow, and very, you know, very disciplined actor. And we were doing this scene, and he had this long kind of monologue where he explains what he wants me to do, and he's giving me this assignment. And at one point, he comes over to show me something, and he had all these papers, and he dropped them on the floor, and his hands were shaking. And I thought, oh, this poor devil, you know, this young actor hasn't acted that much, and he's in this big show now, and you know, he's nervous, and he's so scared, and he dropped. I said, oh, my God. I said, let me, here, that's all right, son, here. And I reached down, and I helped gather his papers up, and I gave them to him, and he said, thank you, but, and we, Francis said, okay, let's do another take now, and he's getting along the same way, and he's talking, and his hands are shaking. He comes over to give me the stuff, and he drops them again. I thought, oh, Christ, this poor devil will never get through this scene, and I said, oh, that's okay, kid, and I picked it all up, and I'm handing it to him, and he says, thank you, and we get to another take, and he does it pretty much the same way, and he's coming over to me and saying this line, his hands are shaking, and he drops the stuff, and as I go to pick him up, he grabs my hand, and he said, Martin, I'm doing it on purpose.
That was part of the scene. Wow, that's funny. Well, who would have, yeah, that was right before that, because 76 is the year before the first Star Wars.
He had filmed Star Wars, but it hadn't been released
yet. Nobody knew, yeah.
Who knew?
Right. Well, and then the heart attack though happened around.
It was March 5th, in 77.
Yeah. And so you were on your own at that.
I was on my own. Yeah. Jan and I went back, just the two of us, because most of the time we had the kids there mm-hmm. with us in the first two phases. This was phase three because after we filmed Marlon's stuff and quite a lot of stuff with the choppers and all. And then we were all finished with that, and we took a break at Christmas, and we came home at Christmas, and then we went back in January to finish what they call the final phase of the film, Phase 3. And so there were no helicopters necessary and mm-hmm. not a lot of action, and so we thought, well, this would be simple enough. And so just Jan and I went ourselves. We were supposed to only be gone maybe 6 or 8 weeks, less maybe, you know. Fine, we're in the home stretch now. And we were filming for a couple of weeks, and we had rented a cottage up in this, near this volcanic lake area where we lived before. And there was no kitchen up there. There was no phones or anything. And so we had a driver who we're still friends with, Reno Mahar. He was my driver and bodyguard the whole time. And he was Charlie's driver and bodyguard on Platoon years later. Isn't that interesting?
That is funny.
And so Reno would come and collect us to go to the set or go out, down to town. It's about 5 miles above Baksanhan, which is where the main production was done. And we would go into Manila on weekends. There was a bus that went in, or if you could get a ride, I usually let Reno have the weekend off, if I wasn't working, and so he could be with his family, and he'd take the car and go. And Jan and I'd take a bus in, or, the company had a bus that went in all the time. Or you can get a public transport, a couple-hour trip to Manila, and we'd take rooms at a hotel, and call home and eat a lot of food and enjoy the air conditioning, right. And then go back into the jungle on Sunday night. And so that was our routine. And so, but this one weekend, we were planning on going in, and the World Bank was having a big convention in Manila, and all hotel rooms were like hen's teeth. You just couldn't get one. And so Janet said, I'd better get in there and get us a room, because I had to work on Saturday. Usually I had Saturday and Sunday off, but this day they had me. They said, you have to work on Saturday in the morning only, but then you can go to Manila in the afternoon. I said, okay, fine. So Janet said, I'll go ahead and get us the room at the hotel where we all stayed. And I said, okay, I'll join you later. So I was in the cabin alone that night, and I was reading a couple of different books. I'm always reading something, and mm-hmm. I'll leave one open in this room, and then I'll go to another room, and there's a book open there. And so wherever I am at the time, or out on the porch, where I'll just pick up that book and start reading it. So I was reading into the night, and I went to sleep, and I woke up, and it was a very windy night. I remember early in the morning, the winds were just knocking the trees against the house, and whoosh of wind going across. It wasn't raining, but it was very, very windy. And so I kept getting waken up in the night, and I was just feeling strange, And then at one point, I felt as though somebody had... I woke up out of a sleep, and it felt like a clamp had been placed on the inside of my elbows, And it was like I couldn't move my arms. And I started to get up to go to the toilet, and boom! It was like an elephant just kicked me in the chest. And I got very faint, and I thought, whoa, hello, what's going on now? And I started to sweat. That's odd. It wasn't hot. It was still dark out. It was maybe 4 in the morning. And so I thought, God, I started getting dizzy, and I thought, maybe I should pay a little attention to what's going on. I had to go to the toilet, And so rather than getting up and walking, because I thought, you're dizzy, I crawled to the toilet, and I got up on the toilet, and I I was sweating profusely, and I started really getting dizzy, and the pain began to get very intense, and I began to get double vision, you know, and I thought, I think I'm dying, and I better get out of this joint, because they'll never find me here, you know. So I got off the toilet, and I pulled on my clothes on the floor, because I was afraid to get up, you know. Mm-hmm. I pulled my boots on, and I pulled a shirt on, and a pair of trousers, and I crawled along, when I got out the door, and I crawled out on the porch, and I crawled down the steps, and I had about maybe 500 yards to go up the hill to the gate, you know, walk through this little forest to the gate. It was like a private residence, and there was a guard out at the gate. I said, well, I got to go get some help. And so I started, and I stood up. It was the first time that I said, well, I got it. I stood up, and I said, whoa, Jesus. And the it looked like I put, you know, how you put a pair of glasses on, and it's not your prescription, and you, you know, suddenly you get dizzy. Mm-hmm. And I, the earth got very far away, and then I went deaf, and then I went blind. Mm-hmm. And I went down on the grass, and I thought, oh, Jesus, this is what it's like to die. And I thought, and I wasn't afraid. Oddly enough, I just said, what an interesting experience. Mm-hmm. Wow, death is nothing to be afraid of, mm-hmm. you know? At least not now. Mm-hmm. I thought, this is interesting. And I started crawling up this hill and into this wooded area, and there was a ringing in my ears. And I remember I finally got to the road, crawled most of the way, and I sat on a rock. And the guard there said, oh, he knew me, you know. He said, what is wrong? I said, I'm very sick. I said, could you help me get back down to Paxanhan? Oh, God, he said. And people were starting to come up the hill for the morning shoot. The wardrobe people and mm-hmm. jeepneys were coming and going. And he stopped one of them, and they put me on board and drove me back down to... And then going back down the mountain, the wardrobe truck was coming up, and I said, oh, I work with those people. And so they transferred me under the wardrobe truck, took me down to the compound, and they had a doctor come and see me. And he, one look at him looking at me, I knew I didn't look so hot, you know. He was a young guy. I knew him from before. He was a company doctor. And so it wasn't looking good. And Francis came and said, we're going to take care of you, don't worry. And you have a chance, you have a choice here. If you want to go to Manila, we'll fly you in a chopper. I hated choppers. Mm-hmm. I just was terrified of them. It was the last thing I wanted to do. And they said, we can get you there in like 15 minutes. Or, you know, we can take you in a car or the bus, and you can lay down the bus, and it'll take a couple of hours. And I said, okay, let's take a chopper. And the wind was blowing so severely. I remember the trees were really swaying. And so they put me in a chopper, and Dick White flew it. And the doctor and I were in the back, and it was ballast in front. Dick White was pretty heavy. He was a combat pilot in Vietnam, and he had done all the aerial arrangements for the attack on that mm-hmm. village. It was mm-hmm. Dick White. He's the guy in the film. He says, mayday, mayday, I'm going down.
Right.
He's a real guy, mm-hmm. you know. And so Dick flew the chopper in, and the other fellow in the front was our naval advisor, Pete Cooper, who doubled for Marlin. He was big 6 foot guy, former PBR sailor in Vietnam, and he was an expat who lived in the Philippines, married a Filipino girl, was helping us, you know. And so they were in the front, and the doc and I were in the back, and they flew me in, and they landed in this field near the hospital, you know. There were an ambulance waiting. They threw me in the ambulance and got me to Makati Medical Center, and I was rolled down these corridors, and I was like, you know, in the movies, and you see lights passing and people, and this one little face came and just kind of stayed there, and I kind of look at it, and then I realized it was Janet, you know. Mm-hmm. When she realized that I knew who she was, she smiled, mm-hmm. and she leaned down and whispered in my ear, it's only a movie, babe, and I started getting well.
Right
then.
I hate to have to gloss over so much more because I would love to ask you, but
you didn't realize what a windbag.
No, I think it's
you're
a great.
Get out of here.
No, it's a great oral history, and I wish honestly it kills me that I can't ask you more about all the things, Gandhi, Wall Street, West Wing, but what I know the thing that we have to do.
You're not going to survive it.
No, I
this
would.
This is longer than a podcast.
No, maybe if one day, if you'll do it, I would love to do part two. But the thing that I know is probably most important to you and I need to do justice to as well, and I so that people will see it, is obviously ask you about The Way, which I know that I think Emilio or Charlie or maybe both have said they think that it's your best work since Apocalypse.
Yeah, I'd agree, yeah.
And so...
But it's also like the first, you know, leading role
for
I
a film part
of substance, you know.
Right.
Since Apocalypse.
Because
yeah,
you'd gone and done a lot of TV.
Yeah, I've done a lot of TV and a lot of crap, you know.
Well, so the, you know, as I mentioned, I saw it. It's been a bit, I know to just my own, for you, it's, I'm sure it feels even longer, but I'm just thinking, I saw it for the first time in Toronto, 2010.
Wow.
The first cut.
Mm-hmm.
I guess that was actually the first screening publicly.
It was, yeah. And I think it was like 2 hours and...
A little longer than what it is now.
Yeah.
So there was that. Then in 2011, there was the screening with Bill Clinton in New York.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the second
time. It was a benefit
time.
For the Walkabout Foundation.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then most...
That was the final cut. It was an hour and 54 minutes, I think.
And I think it was tied in very nicely.
Mm-hmm.
And then the most recent time was in 2012 with just on a screener with
just
some
now.
Friends.
Oh, really?
So to for me, it's been 3 years. For you guys, mm-hmm. and I know you were involved with just even the development of the idea of it, mm-hmm. It's got to feel a lot longer. But the real beginning, I guess, is with... your trip out there. So can you share that?
Well, I had a brother. We were so-called Irish twins. He was like a year and 3 months older than I. And so he was always one step ahead of me. I'd get his used books, his used clothes, his used thoughts, you know, his advice on what teachers to avoid and what mm-hmm. things to expect. And as I, you know, would go into his class, mm-hmm. always a year ahead of me. And I adored him. He was the one I was closest to growing up. And I lost him in 2001. He died of cancer. Mm-hmm. And he was like the fourth brother we'd lost over the years. And I said, you know, I'm tired of going to funerals. Let's have a celebration. And so I contacted all the remaining siblings. I grew up in a big family. We were 9 boys and 1 girl. My mother actually had 12 pregnancies, but 10 survived, 9 boys, 1 girl. I was the 7th son. Mm-hmm. And there were, at this time, there were 5 of us still alive. 6? No, one's died since then.
Mm-hmm.
So still living now are Carmen, John, Joe, and myself, and Frank, you know. So the 4 Yanks, we were all born in the States, mm-hmm. and Frank was born overseas. Mm-hmm. So all the Yanks, knock wood, are still alive. And so I decided that I would organize a reunion of all the living siblings, and they were all over the joint, mm-hmm. you know. I have a brother, Joe, he's an actor, lives here. I said, I'm going to get everybody to Ireland for a reunion. And this was the summer of, the spring of 2003, and I was on hiatus from the West Wing,
mm-hmm.
and I had, you know, like six, eight weeks off, and so I organized this reunion in my mother's hometown, Borders of Cane County, mm-hmm. Tipperary, on May 22nd, 2003, which would have been my mother's 100th birthday. Wow. Mind you, she died in 1951. He's 48, mm-hmm. you know. But I thought, what an auspicious mm-hmm. day to gather in this village. And we would have a mass in the church that her father, my grandfather, had slated. You know, he was a master slater. That's a lost art. But in the old days, people's roofs would be slated in the old country. And so that's what he did. And he owned a pub as well. So everybody said, that's a great idea. So my son Ramon and I organized this. And we went over to Ireland. And I invited Matt Clark, my old dear friend, who's in the movie. He plays the rabbi/priest. He gives me the rosary.
Right.
And I knew Matt longer than I did. I met Matt at the Living Theater in 1959.
Oh, really?
He was a stage manager and fellow actor and a great friend of Al Pacino as well. That's how I met him. Al was through Matt.
Oh, really?
And so the Irish thought, because it seemed whenever I went to Ireland, I was always with Matt.
Yep.
He directed Da, the Irish film from the Hugh Leonard play. And so it seemed every time I was in Ireland, it was with Matt. And so my Rels,
came to that one.
All the Rels thought he's a brother.
Right.
We invited him to the
That's great.
To the reunion.
Right.
And he came.
And we had this great three-day celebration, and I brought Taylor, my grandson, who was 19 at the time. This is Emilio's oldest child.
Right, right.
And he was working for me as an assistant
right.
on the West Wing, and he was just out of high school. And right. So the three of us went to Ireland, and then we had, with all the other rails we hooked up with in Ireland, had this wonderful three-day celebration, and then we all went down to Dublin and spent a few days just touring around, and I invited everybody, come with me to Spain, because we're all going to walk the Camino. And right. nobody was interested.
Right.
Matt was, and Taylor were stuck with me, so they said, whoa.
Did you know what you were suggesting?
I didn't have a clue. I had this romantic image. Right. I'm going to walk the Camino Santiago de Compostela.
Right, right.
You know, I'd wanted to do it for so long. Right. My father was born in a little village called Barajubia Salta Revolta, very near Santiago in Galicia, maybe 80 kilometers. I knew about this thing, and I romanticized. I wanted, it was like wanting to go to college, you know, that I'd never done. And I thought, as an old guy, I'll go to college. I did for one semester. It was a disaster. Great fun, right. but, you know, I was right. not a student. Right. I was 65. Right. Come on, you know. Now I know why they go to school when they're young. Yeah. At any rate, but it was great fun. And I my only regret is I didn't do it when I was a kid, mm-hmm. you know. My father was right.
Right.
At any rate, the three of us went by ourselves. Couldn't get anyone. All the brothers, we got to get home, got to do this, got to do that. Okay, fine. We're going to go and do the Santiago de Compostela Camino. So we went to Madrid. My sister Carmen lived in Madrid. She had an apartment in the old section on Atoche, mm-hmm. Calle Atoche, which is in the middle of the old section. And lived there for years and was a teacher. She and her husband were teachers and so forth. And so we met there, and we were planning our trip. And I had about 3 weeks left before I had to come back here to begin the new season of the West Wing. How am I going to do the Camino? A guy in his, you know, 20s, maybe 30s, a guy in good shape could walk the Camino, tops maybe 3.5 weeks, you know. I was already, 63. It's not going to happen. And I didn't have any equipment. I didn't even have a map. All I had was this idea, you know. Mm-hmm. But I was determined to do it. And I found out you could do it on a bicycle, you could do it on a horseback, and we checked out either one, but didn't have enough time. And so we did the only practical thing. We rented a car, like any American any ingenuity would do, and we drove the Camino.
The whole thing?
We went north right from Madrid to Burgos, and Burgos is one of the major cities. Right. That's where El Cid is buried in the Catedral in Burgos.
Yeah.
And it's where the boy steals my bag in the movie.
Yeah. Yep.
The gypsy community. That's where that whole thing happened in Burgos. And that gypsy community, they are Rio Gitanos, and they live in Burgos. Yeah, we had a connection through Taylor. At any rate, we got up to Burgos, and we're looking for a refugio for the night. And they were all packed. And somebody said, there is a Casa Rural out in the wilderness, if you have a car, you can go out there. They'll take pilgrims, and it's about 20 kilometers from here, and we'll call and tell them you're coming. And we said okay, and so and the place was called El Molino, which means the mill. So mm-hmm. we went out there, and sure enough, they had a place for us, and we stayed overnight. It was wonderful. And the next day, Matt, who was the only guy who knew, of the three of us, knew how to drive a standard shift, mm-hmm. said, I'm not doing this all the way to mm-hmm. Santiago. You guys are going to have to learn how to drive the standard. Mm-hmm. So, oh, okay. So Taylor took his first lesson, mm-hmm. and I walked to the next village, and then they caught up with me, and Taylor walked to a village, and I learned how to drive it. And along the road, we found this wonderful hot springs, you know. And we're sitting in the hot springs. He said, you know, this is a wonderful, wonderful place. Why don't we go back to the Molino and see if we could stay another night? Mm-hmm. So we did. We went back, and they said, yes, okay. We got our own rooms back, and we were invited to the Pilgrim Supper, and there are people from all over the world, pilgrims from everywhere at this supper. And in comes this beautiful young girl serving us supper. And Taylor, I saw him. He looks at her. I saw her look at him. They're still looking at you. Fell desperately in love instantly, and they're still together. He married her.
Oh my
they were
goodness,
married,
so
and they live there now.
Connection to
and
them.
And so I came home. I had some splaining to do to my son, to what happened to Taylor. Oy. And it was for real.
Right.
And on the ride home, I remember Emilio's Taylor telling me, my heart is, this has never happened. I said, you're 19, but I understand. Look, I was married. I was 21. I know. I said, he said, but I can't live without her. I said, you mustn't live without her. You don't have to live with her. You'll live with her. I sound like Francis.
I didn't say
that. So he did. Weeks later, he went back.
Oh,
Wow. And he's been there ever since.
Wow.
And so that was the beginning.
So Emilio had better go visit.
Yeah, so I started bothering him. He was working on Bobby at the time.
Yeah.
And I'd go down there and bother him. He'd see me coming, you know. I'd say, you know what? There's a wonderful idea for a story. Two old guys on the Camino with a young kid that falls in love right under their nose and they don't see it.
Right.
That's a great story, isn't it? He said, yeah, maybe, but it's a one-line joke. You know, how far are you going to go with a movie? Eventually, he started going overseas and spending time with his son and got familiar with the Camino and with pilgrims coming and going, and he began to study the Camino, and he fell in love with his new in-laws, and eventually he said to me, you know, I feel as if I've lost a son on the Camino. Not tragically, of course, but in order to see him, now I got to go there. He said, maybe that's what the story's about. It's a father and son story. It's a story of loss. It's a father who loses his son. Boom. And then it hit him. You know, this guy who lives a very isolated life up in Ventura here in Southern California is suddenly pulled out of his comfortable environment, his country club, his practice, you know, he's an ophthalmologist professional. He's a widower. He's by himself in the world. He's estranged from this son, the only boy. And he's made to go to this foreign country and deal with this loss and bring the boy home. That's all he's got. While he's there, he finds out what the boy was doing. He was on pilgrimage. What's that about? And he discovers the Camino, and he decides to do the Camino in his son's stead. So he has the body cremated, carries the ashes, and leaves them along the way. And that's the story.
And obviously the subtext for anybody who knows who's involved with the movie is that you've got, not only is the movie about the father and son relationship, but you obviously have the son directing the father for the film. And so the two-part question here is just, with Emilio the person, we kind of talked about this a little earlier, but like you've said, I quote, I've never really thought of him as my son. I've always thought of him as my brother. I was 21 when he was born. The other kids have no memory of the hard times, or maybe their hard times are a different story. But this guy knows me in ways that I don't even know myself. And so, and then again, he's gone on to direct, you know, I guess you acted with him in the custody of strangers.
Yeah.
But then he directed you three times, The War at Home, Bobby, and now this.
Mm-hmm.
So what can you tell us about your relationship with him that allowed you to collect that, where you both wanted to do this so badly together?
So, you know, I don't know myself without him. You know, our relationship it's sacramental. You know, I think it is between all fathers and sons on different levels. You know, there's an old Irish saying, we never get over our fathers, and we're not required to. Mm-hmm. And what that means really is really a fundamental truth, for good or ill. The father is a central figure in a boy's life, a young man's life, and it's going to remain with you, and it's going to be in large measure influential on how you are going to be toward your son, if you have one, you know, or sons. And so I didn't have a clue about this, and you know, as I say, I was 21 when he was born, and so but something very, very a kind of mysterious happened with his birth. It was like this guy suddenly showed up, and it was like I looked at him, this little baby. It's 1962, he's born. This little baby I'm bringing home, and I'm saying, I'm looking at him, and it was like, oh, you're the guy. I knew this was going to happen. I kind of knew you'd get here. And I see, oh, you're the one. Okay, good. Welcome. You know, it was like, I was giving an interview a long time ago. A guy asked me, he said, tell us about your son, Emilio. Isn't he something? And I said, yeah, I've known him all of my life. And he said, do you mean you've known him all of his life? I said, no, I've known him all of my life. I didn't know that he was the one until he arrived May 12th, 62. But I said, yeah, that's the way I know him. I know him in that, I can't explain it. Fathers, I think, can identify with what I'm saying. You know something about knowingness. You know, a child has a knowingness, it seems to me, that they cannot share. They don't have the experience or the language, but they have a sense of mystery, mm-hmm. a sense of knowingness about themselves mm-hmm. that is only revealed later. And very often it's through an artistic expression, mm-hmm. whether it's drawing or dancing or singing or music or acting, you know, or writing, who knows, mm-hmm. you know. And the arts give us an expression that is so deeply personal and mysterious and sacramental. It's deeply personal. And if it's not personal, it's impersonal. If it's impersonal, who cares? You know what I'm saying? And that's the way it was with Emilio. I mean, he showed up, and I said, "Oh, he's the guy. I'm fine. I'm okay. Everything is fine." And our relationship will develop. Mm-hmm. And it did. You know, it wasn't always pleasant. It wasn't always easy. You know, but we were teachers for each other.
And as much as he obviously loved you enough to write a film for you, basically, and then you loved him enough to say, maybe this film will only
get
do well with someone else.
Yeah, Harrison Ford. Right.
That's a big thing, though. You know, you were involved in the development, all this stuff, and you were ready to pass it off.
Yeah, it's true, because when I read it, I said, oh, my, you know, this... It was like he was a conductor he was a composer who'd written this symphony, and I was the first violinist. And I said, ooh, wow, I haven't, you know, I don't know if I got the fingers, you know, anymore, or the skill to do this. And he said, it's yours, don't you worry. I'll be conducting. I'm the composer, but I know what this is going to sound like, and you're my first violinist. I said, oh, my. And he said, just trust me, you know, it doesn't all happen in the first movement, you know. I've got it structured, so it'll take you on a journey. We're going on a journey together. So, but he was having difficulty getting it done. He'd go to studios and they said, well, you know, a guy walking on a, where's the lady? And I said, well, yeah, a lady shows up. She's kind of broken too. Oh, where's the romance? Where's the fight? Where's the killing? That ain't going to happen, you know. But we knew, it was very clear that he could have sold the script, and any number of those guys, I mentioned Harrison Ford out of great respect and admiration and affection, really, that he would have been wonderful in the part, and he could have got it done in the studio because he'd want to do it, or Michael Douglas, or any one of those guys, you know. It would have been a cinch, you know. But with me, when's the last time Sheen did a feature, you know?
Yeah, but
Apocalypse Now? Okay.
Yeah, but a lot of people, I think, love The West Wing, but, you know, and other things that might have come out.
Yeah, well,
but I just wonder, though, for you, like, could there be anything harder for an actor who is also a father than playing a father who loses a child? I mean, people say it's the worst thing that could possibly happen to a parent. Yeah. And so for you, where, like, you know, some people, I don't know to what extent you would call yourself method versus other, you know, however you get into your character, mm-hmm. but I can't. You know, I guess that's probably not something you'd ever had to do on screen before. Where did you go to get that?
Well, you know, every artist, writers particularly, you know, and actors, of course, but musicians, singers, dancers, composers, you know, painters, all the arts are a personal expression of some personal well, you know, and we have as actors what we call sense memory. So we go into those places when we're given, I would say, like the license. You know, you get a job and say, well, this is your license. Now you can go to that place and explore that theme for this purpose. And so you're kind of invited to go there, and all of us have a lot in store, you know, that. You know, people go to psychiatrists to deal with, but as artists, we go to the source for the purpose of exploring it. And so it's like taking private pain public, but it has a purpose. As long as you have that license or that job, that format to do it, you are protected and nourished, and you go there with very, very tender motive, I would say. If you go there without the license, it's like doing it in a bar, you know. You're going to end up, you know, maybe in the hushkow or on the street or God knows where, you know. It doesn't belong there, although, you know, a lot of people get confused. I've done it myself. But as an actor, that well is always there, and it's personal. Now, no one need know what you're conjuring up, but they know it's something personal. And for their purpose, they're watching the character, so... dealing with the loss of a child in the way, for me, was a deeply personal revelation, pain, that I had to bring public. But it's covered with Tom. Mm-hmm. You know, it's Martin, but it's expressed as Tom. So.
And Emilio he kept saying he had to remind you that this is not, don't be so nice, don't be Martin, don't be
don't
campaigning.
Be Martin.
Right.
He had to remind me that this guy was not an artist. You know, he belonged to a private country club, something that I've never approved of.
Right, right.
He reminded me, every now and then he'd say, hey, Pop, he'd say, you know, this guy you're playing would never vote for Jeb Bartlett. Do I make myself clear?
Right.
You're dealing with an extremely conservative,
right.
You know, unattached,
right.
You know, guy.
Right.
Guy who lives in his own bubble. And we need you to be there, and gradually we're going to bring you out of it. And then that's the journey. That's the way. That's what the whole thing is about. You know, how you want to do this thing on your own, you know, like every red-blooded American, and all these other knuckleheads are just in the way.
Right,
you know?
Right.
And they become his family, you know.
So the last question is just this. You, for this movie, you go to the other side of the world, you walking, running, swimming, sleeping outside, you know, going through rapids. It was obviously something you would only do as a labor of love. It wasn't,
yeah.
This was not a instance of waiting for them to meet the asking price. So you go through all of this, and now you come
you.
Back. Oh, bless you. So now you come back, and you have this movie that, you know, the only reason it could have been made was because you want to share this story. And that becomes a challenge, a huge challenge for you guys that you chose to approach in an unusual, unique way. And so, A, can you just summarize what has gone into getting this movie out to the world now? And B, what do you make of the fact that those people who have seen it thus far have reacted so strongly that you, having not made, like you said, not been part of too many movies in that many years, are now, you know, a part of this Oscar discussion even, where, and Charlie, it must mean a lot to see, I don't know if you've seen this, but he tweeted, quote, "The time is now. My father, Martin Sheen, is currently starring in The Way, written and directed by my brother, Emilio Estevez, and he has given the best performance of his career. Academy Award ballots are due next Friday, today, and we need to ensure that Martin gets nominated. Help spread the word. Martin Sheen Oscar." That must mean a lot to you.
Charlie did. Yeah. I heard he did something like that. I didn't read it, though.
So, you know, obviously, to get that kind of a response from people.
I'll settle for that kind of response from Charlie.
Yeah, from Charlie. Yeah.
Thank you, Charlie.
So, obviously, you know, it means a lot to you, to all the people from your whole family who worked on it, to the extent that you would do what to get it seen by the world. What has been going on since the last...
Well, we've been on this pilgrimage for quite a while.
Right.
We premiered it in Toronto in the festival last year.
2 years,
you know,
ago.
Oh, 2 years ago. Yeah. Oh, you were there,
yeah.
Right. And we got some very good response. We knew that the film needed a re-edit. It was just too long. We just didn't have the dough.
Yeah.
Charlie came up with it.
Wow. Though.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. That needs to be acknowledged.
Because I hadn't heard that. Though.
Yeah. Charlie came up with it.
Wow.
Yeah. So he's very much a part of it.
That's great.
And we didn't have a distributor. We had some offers in Canada, but they, for the most part, just wanted to go to DVD. And we said, no, we think we got something more special. So we came home, you know, we knew how to make this film, and now we realized we had to find out how to distribute it. You know, it's one thing to make a film, it's another thing to get people to see
it.
If
a tree falls in a forest and nobody hears, right.
So... we were very happy with the response. We knew it was a deeply personal one. People were taking it personally. Mm-hmm. We saw that from the reaction when we were present during screenings, and we saw it with the reaction that was coming to us through the mail and through friends and family and so forth. But we didn't have any dough. You know, I guess I'm free to say this now, but the way we started was we knew after a lot of effort, we couldn't get a studio behind us because we didn't have, you know, Harrison Ford,
right.
Or one of those guys that could have done it, you know. So we had to do it on our own. So We got a Spanish partner, and we did the rest ourselves. So it was our investment in family. It's often been said about this, it's a film inspired by a grandson and dedicated to a grandfather. Mm-hmm. It's interesting, isn't mm-hmm. it? And they're bookending the whole family. We're right in the middle, everybody.
Right.
Janet, Emilio, Charlie, Ramon, Renee, my sister Carmen, everybody. Yeah. You know, Paloma did the congas and mm-hmm. the soundtrack, and Taylor was, you know, was our associate producer, our driver, interpreter. He was still living in Spain, still there, of course, and
right.
he helped pave the way from the Pyrenees to Santiago, you know. And so it was that it was about our family, you know. And so we just couldn't let it go. And we borrowed some more dough, and we decided, we got a John Sloss over in New York, a very small independent company who was looking for this kind of picture mm-hmm. to try out, you know. We got a small independent deal with the AMC to distribute it, but we didn't have any budget to do publicity,
of course,
and certainly no national publicity, mm-hmm. which is what you need now. If you're going to have a successful film, you got to beat people over the head, you know, at the during intermissions of the football games
yeah.
or the whatever,
right.
you know,
right.
people got to know this film's out there. And we didn't have that. We knew we weren't going to get that. And so we decided to do a bus tour, like our own pilgrimage across the country.
Mm-hmm.
So we rented a bus, and they put the logo on all sides of it, and we started off right out here in front of the house, and we went 14,000 miles, 29 different venues. We played the film to some university campuses, specifically Notre Dame,
mm-hmm.
University of Michigan, and Virginia Tech, where we got the most extraordinary response. Emilio wanted to go there because he said, this film is about healing,
mm-hmm.
and Virginia Tech knows a lot about healing.
Right.
So that was a big stop along mm-hmm. the way. And they invited us, you know. It was a tremendous reception. And so we went around the country, a lot of major cities, a lot of campuses and small towns even, and we would do publicity, local publicity, and we would screen the film twice each night, and we would do Q&A afterwards, and the screenings were free, invited audience. Sometimes they were what they call target audiences. We thought, well, the lead character is kind of an older guy. We got the AARP to give us a screening here during their convention.
Right, right.
Maybe older people
yeah,
would be
sure.
inspired to
course,
put
yeah.
a heavy backpack
right.
on and walk across the mountains. Who knows, you
and
know?
A lot of faith-based.
Yeah, a lot yeah. of faith-based yeah. Yeah. people.
Right.
And we began to create word of mouth. And that was basically all
and,
we had.
And you've outgrossed all these other much bigger movies that had they cost more to promote than your budget was.
Well,
and
we would have taken
yeah.
some of their,
right.
you know, their, what do you call it? Their
P&A precedent, yeah, yeah, yeah.
So we would have taken anything. And, you know, what kept us going, frankly, was we knew we had a very special film.
Mm-hmm.
It had no violence, it had no vulgarity, no degradation of the human condition. It had healing, it had humor. It had people who came to grips with their common humanity, their brokenness, and how magnificent it is to be human, despite how badly you're broken. You know, to know that you're human, you're alive, and that anything is possible, particularly love, compassion, healing, forgiveness, joy, ascendance. You know, that's what it's all about. And so we went with that, and the reaction has just been overwhelming. The letters we've gotten particularly have been, and a lot of it fathers and sons, you know, a lot of fathers and sons go, a guy will go see it and then he'll go get his son and
mm-hmm.
take him, or a son will go see it and go take the old man and insist mm-hmm. they see it, you know.
And the women like it too. It's
the women like it.
Yeah.
Good. Yeah. It's a very, very positive film. It's a confirmation of life. It starts with a great, great loss, and it takes us on a journey of acceptance and healing and joy, forgiveness and freedom, I think, you know.
Right.
What more could you ask for, you know, to be inspired in a film? Nobody feels bad,
right.
you know, about being a human being, about making mistakes, you know. It's so...
Well, and I think Emilio put it as well as you, and you put it excellent, but that idea that it's not, it seems that it's going to be about the death of the son, but it's really about the rebirth of the father, so
very, very
I think
welcome.
That's... But I got to let you go. I can't thank you enough for doing this. It's been unbelievable, and I've been a fan of yours for as long as I can remember. And I
wish, never want to see me again.
No, I would. No,
what a windbag I am.
I would give anything to do part two one day. It was great. But thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Thanks a lot, man. I appreciate it.